lesson. We've been studying the walk of the Christian believer. It's been a very involved study, and it's been fairly deep, I think, and detailed, but I think it's good information, beneficial, to help us learn what Christ wants from us, how he wants to walk, how he wants us to walk in life. I'm going to go ahead and get us where we're going to be this morning. We're in chapter 5, and we're going to be talking, we still got one more verse to finish up with regards to the church and their subjection to Christ, but then we're going to jump into the husbands. And so it's going to start to get a little bit warm in here for the men. But anyways, before we get started, I'd like us to go to the Lord in a word of prayer. And I will go ahead and lead us in that once I get this up. All right, here we go. Gracious Holy Father, we come before you, Lord, thankful for this day that you've made, for giving us life and health. Lord, in light of our shortcomings and trespasses, you're always faithful, Lord, to look out for us, to care. And Father, I pray that you would just continue to do so. Please help us along the way to yield ourselves to you, to become more set apart, to become a people that is, and I say this, set apart in the sense of yielded to your scripture, to your word, according to your will for service. And Father, help us to be a people that reflects that commitment. Help us to strive harder. Help us to overcome the sin in our life. I pray, Lord God, that you'll also stay the adversary and his demons, Lord, that would set to derail our track, that would set to hurt our testimony, that's set to tempt us or to bring us down. We ask, Father, that you'll give us strength to overcome. I pray, Lord God, that you'll bless us as we study your word this morning. I ask that you'll guide and direct me by your Holy Spirit. I pray that the Spirit will take control of the lesson in myself. I pray, Father, that you'll move in me, Father, to deliver these things you laid upon my heart, and that it would be according to your truth and only your truth and not mine, because we all know that your word is truth. And so, Father, I pray that you'll be with our pastor as well, that you'll move in him, that you'll deliver through him what you've laid upon his heart this past week. I pray for the salvation of lost souls today. I pray that you'll save souls and change lives. I pray, Father, for the growth and development of your people. Help us to grow and mature in the knowledge and wisdom of your word. Father, please forgive us of our sins and shortcomings. Please help us to be a light in the world. And Father, please watch over and protect our families. We pray you'll keep them healthy and safe. Lord, we ask these favors and blessings just now in Jesus' holy name and for his sake. Amen. All right, so we've been talking a little bit. We've already covered the fact that Christ is the head of the church and he is the savior of the body. That was covered last week. And this whole section that has to do with God's grace revealed in the Christian homes is really kind of twofold. It's showing what the marriage relationship should look like, and also the relationship that Christ has with his church, which is the greater theme of what's being said there. So the greater theme is this great, beautiful relationship that Christ has with his church, but then also how the marriage relationship is designed to mimic or to look like that same type of relationship. And really, I want to say this, and I don't think I said it last week, but you know, there's a lot of different viewpoints about marriage in the world. There's a lot of different ideas about, you know, what constitutes a marriage. I'm not trying to reinvent the wheel here. I'm not trying to argue for or against that. I feel like these lessons that we're presenting here are for believers. It's designed to help those that believe, have a faith and trust in Jesus Christ as their personal savior, who want to put their life in line with what God has said biblically. And that's really what it's for. I'm not here to try to change somebody's mind in the world. I mean, I'd love for people to study God's word and try to put their life in line with it, because I think they're going to find the greatest joy and success in life, even in light of our trials and tribulations. But the goal here is really to help believers grow in their relationship, not only in their unions one with another, but in their relationship with God. That's what we're trying to do. And we're trying to help people see how what God has designed, what God has put in place, as weird as it looks to the world's way of doing things, it's actually because it's actually more beneficial, because God created man and he created woman, and he knows what's going to make them happy, what's going to make them full, what's going to make their lives rich. And so this is what the goal of these series of lessons are for, and why the Apostle Paul wrote this church at Ephesus to reveal these things to those Ephesian believers, that they might have the fullest relationship, not only with Christ, but in their marriage unit. Okay, but also as a church as well, because the church is to be in subjection. So we had been talking last week about the subjection of the wives. Well, the church is to be in subjection as well. In the first part of this verse, Paul continued, and we're talking about verse 24, which I'm going to bring up here in just a second. But in the first part of this verse 24, Paul continued his analogy of a church and its standing with Christ as illustrative of a relationship between a wife and her husband. Notice what it says. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything. So he's drawing this parallel. He's showing that the church is subject unto Christ. And the word therefore actually is pointing back to something. It points back to the apostles' reference to Christ as the Savior of the body. And essentially, because that is so, the church is subject unto Christ. Because Christ is the head, and he's the head because he's the Savior of the body, there wouldn't be a church without Christ. There wouldn't be anything that would be beneficial as this assembly unless Christ was the one who was the head of it and the Spirit was the one moving in it and it was subject or yielded to its head. So understand this, as a church, we have a great deal of things to consider by this revelation. And that is that we, one, need to be a body that understands that Christ is our head. We got to understand that he's the Savior of the body. As a result of that, we need to yield ourselves to his leadership, our headship, because after all, if we're going to do things successfully, we need to do things in accordance with what the head is directing. And so where do we get that information? We get it in God's word. It's already been revealed. And so all we're trying to do is understand it and apply it. And when we understand it and apply it, and we don't do this by ourselves, it's really something that the Holy Spirit of God does with us, through us, and God's word reveals unto us. We have his help, and we have his care. We have his desire for us to see us be brought into this subjection, to this place, because when we're yielded that way, we're going to find that we're going to be more successful as a church. We're going to be able to bring him honor and glory, which is fitting and also well-received. And we're going to be a body that represents our Savior. And that's really what we're trying to do. Therefore, subjection is necessary. It's absolutely necessary for the success and well-being of our church. Note that the submission addressed in this entire context is voluntary in nature, whether it is the subjection of the church to Christ or a wife to her husband. Now, after what I just said, you might say, well, how is it voluntary? Well, it's still voluntary. Look, at any moment of time, this church can choose to not follow Christ as his head or to run independently of Christ's leadership for us. I'm not going to say we haven't done that because we're sinful beings. It was probably unintentional. But I'll tell you that what this church, I can say, I believe, from my knowledge of the membership body here, that it's not our desire at all to run contrary to the headship of Christ, because we understand that the day we do that, we put ourselves in jeopardy. And I don't think anybody as a member of this church wants to stand before God on judgment day and answer for such a crime. You know, I don't. So I want Christ as my head, because that's what's going to make us successful. And I'm not necessarily saying monetarily or numerically. I'm talking spiritually, you know? And so I would rather be in a smaller church that is completely aligned with God than in a large one that's not. I'd rather be in a poor church that's completely aligned with God than a rich one that's not. And that's just the way I feel about it. Because that church is rich. that poor church is rich in other ways. And that's really what is going to make a difference. So the church can opt to run independently of the will of God. And there's a church can refuse to acknowledge the lordship of Christ, but a congregation that chooses to do so can neither escape nor avoid the consequences of such actions. And there will be. I mean, it's inevitable, because we're running contrary to the one to whom gives us the power to exist. When Christ, after his resurrection, and he met the church on the hill, he says, all power is given unto me, or in the mountain, he says, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. And that power is the word ousia, and it means authority. So all authoritative power is given unto Christ Jesus. Why would a church, a body of believers, ever want to separate themselves from that? Okay, so it's not, it may happen unintentionally, but intentionally is a whole nother thing. But there would be consequences as a result, because the Father has said, the Son shall have lordship. And that's the will of the Father concerning the Son. He will receive the glory. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. And so to run contrary to that is a grave mistake. The matter of subjection to Christ is critical for a church. A congregation that persists in acting independently of its head and Savior might continue to look and act like a church, but it will eventually lose its distinctive essence. And when you think about that, it's so true. I've experienced that over the years, not necessarily here, but I've seen how that can be the case and what the impact of it is. So that's something as a church we should take and be on guard against, making sure that when we walk according to the will of God, according to the truth of his word. And to be able to do that, you got to know the word. It's very difficult. When you're in a situation where a church is trying to go one way and the ones that are leading it that way don't understand the scriptures, because they're leading poorly at that point, meaning not that the effort or the heart isn't there. That certainly may be there, but if we're not leading in line with the truth of God's word, then our leadership is flawed. And so it's important that we individually, everyone that's a member of our church needs to individually be growing in the scripture so that we might do our part to support the body. And as when the devil gets in there and he starts poking and pinching, you know, and he likes to do that, we can see it together. And it may not be me that sees it, maybe my brother or my sister that sees, and they say, hey, wait, this is not in line with what the scriptures are teaching. As a church, let's look at this. That's why we got to know what God's word says, so that we know how to defend ourselves against attacks or against situations that may arise. But to not be in a situation where we're saying definitively, this is what it is because someone said it. Who said it? I'll be honest with you. Over the years, I've been criticized because I'm one of those people that'll say, great, I love you and you're my brother or sister in Christ, but I want to see it in scripture. I want the scripture to tell me. So just show me the scripture. I ain't going to believe it until I see it in here, or I'm not going to embrace it. I may believe it, but I'm not embrace it until I see it in the scriptures. That's what I want. That's why my ministry is more detailed, because that's the way I like to look at things. That's the way I want to receive things. If someone says that God's word teaches this, show me where it teaches. I want to embrace the truth. I want to grow in that. Increase my knowledge. Make my heart and my brain thrive, you know? And so as a church, we have a responsibility not only to God, but to each other, to understand the scriptures and to grow in them to the point where we can help others, including our own congregation. Then we become effective tool for Christ. I didn't have this in the outline because we'd have like 50 pages, but we become an effective tool for Christ when it comes to our witnessing and our service to him outside of the congregation and in the world. So it says, we'll just talk a little bit about the wife's subjection one more time, because it was a part of this verse 24. This verse concludes with the admonition, so let wives be to their own husbands in everything with regard to subjection. As with the relationship between a church and Christ, a wife can refuse to submit to her husband as the head of the home. But there are possibly some unfortunate and even unpleasant results for their marriage and home. Now, that said, I wanted to throw this in too, because husbands can refuse to properly lead and head the family. And that's a problem too. There's a lot of husbands that don't want to take on that role. Don't want to, because you want your wife to follow you? Lead. That means you're the first one up. Now, I'm not the first one up on Sundays. because she takes long showers. But what I'm saying is the idea is of being the first to do it. Lead by example. And that's a challenge for all of us. And I'll tell you this. I when I say stuff like that, I sit back and my brain just flashes. You know, have you ever seen the shows where at the end of this, you know, someone's dying and their life is flashing before them? Mine's going toot, 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 toot. And I'm seeing all the things. And of course, the flashes that I get in my eyes are failures and that responsibility or role. Because that's what the devil likes to show me. There's been a lot of successes. But at the end of the day, what I will conclude is, at different ages, at different stages in life, the challenges are different. Meaning what we face to fill that headship, to be that right leader, can be a hindrance. And sometimes, like say you're in your 20s, it might be more of a challenge in your 20s than it is in your 30s. Or your 40s might be more challenging than your 50s, but vice versa for some other people. Because of things that come into our life and the different situations we find ourselves. We're challenged sometimes financially. We're challenged sometimes with work. There's a lot of people that are being challenged right now with regards to their work situation. They're being told, do this or you lose your job. So they're being faced with a lot of challenges that was brought about by a pandemic that now what was just a foregone conclusion that they would be working is not necessarily the conclusion. So these things are going to create situations in the home that's going to make it very difficult. And so a lot of people are going to be challenged with regards to their role as husbands and wives in the home. And so leading is a work, and headship is a work. It's you're really serving your family. You know that he is service-minded with regards to his church. What would we be if Christ wasn't serving us in the church? And I'm not meaning in serving us like prostate. I mean serving us as the head, as taking care of us, as our protector, watching out for us, providing us spiritual increase, making our mind to understand, helping us to have that desire and that passion, keeping us from danger and harm. He's constantly working or serving this body for its welfare. And he does this willfully, happily, joyfully, because of his love for us. So it's a commitment. So husbands can refuse to properly lead and head a family. This can equally produce some unfortunate and even unpleasant results for their marriage and home as well. And sometimes women, unfortunately, have to step into that role and take on that headship. It shouldn't ought to be that way. We should be striving to lead and taking on the responsibility that God requires of us to take on for their sake, for his honor and glory, for our sakes. That said, if a woman has any hesitancy about the consequences of her being in subjection to a man whom she intends to marry, she should do some serious soul searching before she consents. Honestly, why do you think, you know, that's what going out and dating and getting to know somebody is all about. It's what the engagement really is kind of about too. Learning to understand who this person is and what they're about, you know. Cute only goes so far. You know what I'm saying? It only goes so far. So it's important. And I think this is applicable for the male as well. You know? It's funny. We found these two little puppies while we were hunting back in. And this is going to come out bad. I already know I'm getting myself in trouble with this. We were out hunting in Arkansas. My daughter had gone out with her husband, and she'd gone into the backcountry, and she was back in the middle of nowhere. And they're like all creeping around in this tall grass, and they hear this little sound coming from the grass, and they turn around. She sets. She gets in her position to shoot, and two little puppies come walking out of the grass. I'm talking puppies, like 10 weeks. They looked horrible, flea and tick ridden. And when they got them back to the cabin we were staying in, this female puppy looked so just sweet. And she was just like humbled. And the male looked like he had been trying to keep the whole group going, the two of them going. He looked beat up and rough and yeah, it had all kind of bites on him. But as these dogs began to get fed and they started to get cleaned and they started to get well taken care of and spooned over, I mean, in the cabin we had, they became the life of the cabin there. This little girl, she got feisty. And she got, by the time we got back to California with those dogs, man, I'll tell you what, she's about ready to take the head off a grown adult. And I thought, man, what a change for this one. She was just the sweetest. You see where I'm going? She was just the sweetest thing. And then she turned. Okay. So I'm just saying it's on both sides of the aisle. It's important that when we're putting a relationship together, we put it together in Christ, male and female, because I think that's where we're going to see the greatest return, trying to find someone that is equally yoked, aligned with what we're doing and where we're going. And somebody who's willing to yield to that Lord's leadership for their life. Because if a person's willing, male or female, to yield themselves to the Lord's leadership for their life individually, the Lord's leadership for their church corporately, then they're going to have no problem with the Lord's leadership in their family. In fact, they're going to embrace it and want it. They're going to want to employ it. Whoopsie. Don't get to see that second one yet. In these verses we are going to look at next, Paul turns his attention to the husbands and explains their role. As he did in his instructions to the wives, the apostle used the illustration of the relationship between Christ and his church in dealing with husbands. I put dealing with husbands, that rowdy group. Those guys, man, they're just a rowdy crowd. We gotta deal with those guys, those characters. But first of all, what is a church? A lot is said with regards to the church, Christ and his church, but what is a church? Well, as we learned last week, the Greek word for church is ekklesia. And it's a simple word. It just means calling out, a popular meeting, especially a religious congregation. So really, an ekklesia is just really a called out assembly. And so the thing about a called out assembly, in this case, we see Christ doing it on the shores of Galilee. He says, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. And they dropped their nets and they followed him. He's calling them out. And he's starting to assemble this body. And he makes reference to the church in Matthew chapter 18 as he was teaching them about personal and public offenses. And so you can see what Christ was doing here is calling out. And what was interesting, he was calling out a certain people. Like if he said, and he was walking upon the shores of Galilee and he saw two brethren. So who he was calling out were those people that were of John's disciples. In the book of Malachi, it talks about the one crying in the wilderness, go and prepare ye the way of the Lord. And so John the Baptist is out preaching the wilderness. He says, repent and be baptized. Repent and be baptized as a result of the remission of sins. So he was teaching them about the coming kingdom, about the Messiah. He was teaching about their need for salvation, and those that believed and accepted Christ or the Messiah as their Savior, he baptized them. Well, some of these men, Jesus saw fishing. He says, I saw two brethren. He says, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. So this called out assembly was a couple things. One, it was called out of a specific group of people. They were saved, baptized believers. And because it was an assembly that could be called out, it was also always local, meaning that. And I'm going to show you in scriptures that it was always local. I didn't put all the scriptures in here with Jesus calling out. You can go in the Gospels and read just about any one of them, but I think John's the only one. Don't have a record of it to some degree. But you can go and you can, maybe it does. I don't know, to be honest with you. But you can go in there and definitely look in Matthew. You can look in Luke. Might be good places. And you'll see him calling out these men, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. I know he goes and gets Matthew as he's doing his job as a tax collector, you know? So he's calling all kind of people, but they were people that either were or would believe. Now Judas was the one question mark, and everyone knows that Judas has kind of attached himself, correct me if I'm wrong, but just kind of attached himself to the group, which is saying something else, which we're not going to get into today. That's another lesson. But it was always a local assembly. I'm going to show you, the book of Acts is probably a really good place to see the local aspect, because it really deals with the first like 30-year history of the church and how it perpetuated and how it grew and how other churches cropped up in other areas, or missionary work of the Apostle Paul in his first, second, third missionary journeys and all that. Some churches were started literally by the persecution of the church in Jerusalem when people spread out and they went out into these other areas and began to share the gospel. But here's some examples. Acts 15:41. And he went through Syria and Cilicia, confirming the churches, plural. So he was in Syria and he was in Cilicia, confirming churches. You're going to see the plural form in all of these verses I'm showing you. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. So those churches that were being referenced there in that verse were established in the faith and increased in number daily. But as God hath distributed to every man, as the Lord hath called every one, so let him walk, and so ordain I in all the churches. And finally, Galatians 1:2, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia. So you see churches in Galatia, you see them in Syria, you see them in Cilicia. And if you were to actually read the book of Acts, you'd see that there was a lot of churches that were really from Jerusalem up to Antioch. There was a church in Antioch, and when Paul would come back to the church at Antioch, who was a sponsoring church for his missionary journeys, he would make his way down to Jerusalem, and they would confirm the churches down to Jerusalem, meaning stop in, visit, make sure they're following the scriptures, are growing in the scriptures, and producing those things that they should be producing as a body in Christ. So then you could really look at a church as being a called out assembly of saved, baptized believers, local, to do the job in that community that they were called to do. And if you look in the book of Acts, whether they were in Galatia or whether they were in Ephesus or they were in Corinth, the church that was there in Corinth, throughout Asia Minor, which I think is Galatia now, is Galatia that considered Asia, Turkey? Asia Minor. A lot of churches in there. There was just a lot of them. And they were all working in their community. And the thing, if you notice, like what Paul wrote the Galatians, the Ephesians weren't having a problem with. What he wrote the Ephesians was to strengthen them. What he wrote to the Corinthians, they had their own problems because of the community they lived in Corinth and all of the deplorable things that was going on in Corinth. But Ephesus had problems in the sense that they had false God worship problems. So, you know, there was all these things that's recorded in the book of Acts, but these people as believers were working within their community to try to help people come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, to understand the scriptures, and to grow in the truth. And that's what a church's function is. That's what we're doing here. Now, fortunately, we live in a time where we can be here and somewhere else too, through the actual technology that we have, but nevertheless, our primary work in particular is in this community, and these people, you know, and if God saves through these process of lessons online and helps people to grow and mature in the Word, well, then praise God, then He's doing the over and above. This picture of the church I liked, because I kind of see, that's how I kind of see us. But I loved about it is the prayer circles. I think churches need more of them. I think the people of the church need more of them. I think prayer circles are very valuable for not only bringing our heart closer to the Lord where it should be, because right now, let's face it, we have a lot of things that want to pull us away. We're dealing with a lot of problems. Sometimes we can come to God's house, we can hear the message, go home, and it while it butters the bread, so to speak, of easing the difficulties of the week or the month, this right here, these circles right here that you see going on, that's where power happens, man. I'm telling you, there's power in prayer, and there's power in unified prayer. I think such a thing like this really honors and glorifies God. And it's an effectual thing, trying to bring about a desired effect. I love that they're holding hands. I love that they love each other enough to spend this time together. I think it's very beneficial for the church. That was just me thinking out loud. But so there is a plurality of churches to which Christ is the head, and this is key, and I'll tell you why it's key. It helps us personalize the admonition. As Christ is to my individual body here, so should I be to my wife. Now, I understand why I say that. If this church is rolling outside of the will of God for it, then that may not necessarily be the case. But the intent of the statement is that it's not. And the intent of the statement is that when we as a body, instead of just saying what God is doing in Ephesus or what he did in Ephesus, where we weren't at the time, we can look into our own, how God has blessed our church, how God has touched our spirit, how God has moved to bring us along or keep us, how God has answered our prayers. We've had a lot of prayers answered. I mean, in the years I've been here, I don't know if I have a number of them. I couldn't even begin to enumerate all the prayers I've seen answered and the Spirit of God moving, not only in my heart and the heart of my brothers and sisters, in the body of the church and the work that people do and how he affects their life. So you can see that Spirit moving. You can see God's care for our church and you can personalize it. So when he says, the way I've loved you, love, then there's something to look at and even experience. It becomes an experiential knowledge because you've experienced it firsthand. And that's what's so key about this local church concept is because it's personal. It's deeply personal. And it puts a higher viewpoint. You can see it more clearly when you apply that standard. Verse 25 says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. See, that giving hasn't ceased. He gave himself for it on the cross of Calvary, but it has not ceased. He's still given himself for it. He has given himself for it each and every day. And we are the benefactors of that. Love your wives, verse 25. Having directed the wives to be subject to their husbands, Paul then wrote, love your wives. You know, that's a command to the man. And it's not just something said in passing. It oh, little squirrel. For all the joking I give her, she's an easy person to love. She's not a grudge holder. She's a chipper person. She's got a great personality and she brightens the room. Unless she's mad at you. I'm not saying I've been on that side, but I might have a couple of times. She's an easy person to love. And I think that there's a heart in a lot of our women for the Lord, and that makes them an easy person to love. And so, you know, the key being love and it being in the Lord. So when we as husbands love the Lord, we'll love our wives. When wives love the Lord, they'll love their husbands. But the command or a call here is to the husbands to love their wives. He's calling the wife to be in subjection, but the husband is to love. But I think God understands that when that is actually prevalent in the home, then the union will thrive in love, and it will benefit. With this simple exhortation, the apostle put everything about the marriage relationship in proper balance and perspective. Husbands who truly love their wives will not abuse the subjection, subjecting of themselves when they receive it from their mates. They'll cherish it. They'll take it as a call to greater responsibility. You know, when you realize as a husband that it's not just you have to provide for and take care of, or you have to shield and protect, you'll step up. You'll want to step up and do a better job to try to make sure that your spouse is provided for. The Greek word translated love is the verb form of agape. So when it says love your wives, it's the verb form. It's action form of love. Agape is basically describing a sacrificial love. Okay, but this is a sacrificial love that is based on principle instead of emotion. So a lot of people love emotionally. Principle love is a deeper love. It's a greater form of it because it's based on the principle that you should love, not just the emotion or feeling of love. It does not become indifferent, nor does it lose focus. And I think, of course, we think of the one passage, probably the best passage with regards to the description of love, is the description of agape in Paul's account of the superiority of charity. That word charity in 1 Corinthians 13 is translated charity, which is basically love in action. But the root word is agape. So it's the same exact word that's used here in this text. And I just happen to have it. This is what it says. It says, charity or agape or love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. It beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. And at the very beginning of verse 8, it says, love never fails. And so there it is right there. It's really the contrary of what we have a tendency to want to be. We might be puffed up. We might be vain in our leadership. We might seek our own. We might be easily provoked. Quit leaving, honey, quit leaving the nightlight on when you get up to turn on. No, I'm just teasing. We fuss with it. I get in trouble for leaving the pocket door to the restroom in the master partially open because someone wants to walk into it in the middle of the night. She'll get up every morning, turn on the light, and she'll leave the nightlight on overhead. And I crack up because I always look up and see it, like that light right there, and say, and I kind of laugh to myself. So those are the things we fuss about. But it can seem sometimes like you're you know, getting feisty with each other and you're not following this. But in reality, it's really talking about a much greater thing. It doesn't boast. It doesn't look it out or lift up itself or edify itself. And it's bearing things, believing things, hoping things, enduring things. Really, I think all those things right there really forge a greater love too. All those things, bearing things, believing things, hoping things, enduring things. Those are the experiential things that build a loving relationship, and one that's concreted and enduring. Okay, so as Christ loved the church... And men, now it's getting real, okay? Because now the word love is elevated. The word love has just been elevated because the manner which husbands are to love their wives is even as Christ also loved the church. It's not just what love we can muster, but there's a standard that's been set, an example that's been put forth. Even as denotes likeness of manner or basis for comparison. The supreme example of how husbands should love their wives is that of Christ and his love for his churches. So now we've got this. This is where I find out I'm a failure because I realize how bad, or I shouldn't say how bad, how much I need to improve when I consider my love as being something equal to as Christ loved the church. I know I'm going to get home today. And she says, okay, here's my list. This is everything you said. Got it right here. This ain't a Christmas list, honey. This is a love list. Yep. Okay. And the ones that aren't checked are the ones you're currently not doing. No, she won't do that. But I'm just saying, when you put it into perspective of Christ's love, now it's a whole nother thing. And there's a value that's being established. Because of his undying and unwavering love for the church, Christ provides everything necessary for its well-being. Nothing is lacking in any regard. So I think, I'm going to take this real quick, run out of time, but I'm going to take this real quick. I'm going to say, okay, twofold part. On one part, as a church, we need to understand that in Christ, we're being provided everything we need. That there's nothing that is lacking. So if things aren't happening, we got to look within ourselves. Are we complacent? Are we not on fire? Are we not allowing or yielding ourselves to Christ to be used because we're more interested in doing other things? Are we just giving the necessary because that's what's necessary? Or is there more we can be getting? Is there more we can be doing? Are we pushing out? Go ye therefore into all nations. Are we pushing out? Okay, so there's that. Then understand the other side of the aisle. The other thing that's being kind of focused on here is as Christ provided everything necessary for its well-being and nothing was lacking, husbands, we have a great responsibility to provide everything for the great well-being. And this is sacrificial. See, that's why it says the Savior of the body, because it was sacrificial. And so nothing was lacking. And that's what the call is for us as well. Similarly, or even as the husband is to promote and encourage the overall well-being, especially emotionally and spiritually, of his home in general and his wife in particular. So there's a great responsibility. We have to know how to do that. And that's why we need to study, because God tells us how to do it in his word. So he needs to promote and encourage overall well-being of his home in general and his wife in particular, especially emotionally and spiritually. Okay, so Christ died for the church. This is established. The depth of Christ's love for the church has been seen in that he gave himself for it. Verse 25. I picked this picture. In my personal opinion, it's not graphic enough. I think the person that's illustrating this picture here, probably from a movie, is in pretty good shape compared to what my Savior was in by the time he got to this point. But nevertheless, it does depict at least an idea, though very shallow, of the real suffering of Christ. He not only paid the redemption price for all mankind, but he also purchased his church with his own blood. And there was a reason why he purchased it. But John 15:13 says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Exactly what Jesus did. He showed the greater love. There's greater love hath no man than this. So the greatest love that could be expressed is one laying down their life for his friends. And that verse, that passage doesn't to say, you are my friends if you do whatsoever I command thee. You show your love in yielding yourself to the commands of our Savior. Sanctified and cleansed. The reason why Christ died for his church was so that he could sanctify and cleanse it. Verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. The word sanctify is from the Greek word hagiazo. And it's an interesting word because it has a root word that is more powerful. But hagiazo comes from this root word. And if you look at the root word and you look at its form as it exists, it means to make holy, purify, or consecrate. The root word for that it comes from is a word that describes holiness on a very high level, like not deity, but essentially the result of purification or the result of consecration. It is describing really what results in an individual when they come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Really, they've been made holy spiritually, even though they retain the worldly flesh and mind. But one day in the resurrection, they will be made, I mean, it's guaranteed. It's already been established, paid for, bought. This body will be resurrected. And at that time, that the fullness of what Christ did for me when I received him as my personal Savior will be made manifest eternally. So this word is kind of going along that line, but there's an element to it that's not only in the moment of salvation, but it's also an element that is something that is progressive over time. You know, I'm not resurrected yet. I'm still living on this earth in this sinful flesh, even though my soul is saved and kept by the Holy Spirit of God, according to Ephesians 4:30. The basic concept is that of being separated or set apart, sanctified. That's the idea of what's being done here. Now, of course, at salvation, we're set apart, we're sanctified, we're saved, and from something to something. But it's progressive as well. It's something, and it's going to require a little bit of time. Through salvation, believers are separated to God for service and worship. It is a willful act on the part of the believer. It is not forced by God. Under the Mosaic law, clean animals were acceptable for sacrifice, and clean people could participate in the tabernacle or temple rituals. Through salvation, believers are not only set apart, but they are also made acceptable for worship and service. And that's what's being driven home here. Generally speaking, the fullest realization of worship and service is experienced through each one's relationship with the scriptural church. So I'm gonna let that sink in for just a second. The fullest realization of worship and service is experienced through each one's relationship with a scriptural church. Why do I say that? Great question. Because the word of God tells us. Ephesians 3:21. Unto him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus, throughout all ages, world without end. That was always God's plan. It's a blood-bought institution paid for with his shed blood. It is where he elects to receive honor and glory, where he elects to minister, where he elects to teach and grow and prosper. So if you have one, you should strive to be a part of it. But also, in addition to that, there's other things. The death of Christ makes that as well as salvation possible. So we are washed by the word. And this is something that I think as we get through this, we're kind of closing this out now, but as we get through this, we're going to see what this means and how important it is. We're trying to come to a place where we understand the husband and the wife, the marriage, the union, how valuable it is, how it pictures the church, how it pictures the church in relationship to Christ, and all these things being brought together, which is such a beautiful picture. Well, here's another aspect of it, or another facet. Washed by the word. The sanctifying and cleansing that results from the death of Christ are positional. Okay, they are positional, like we talked about. What does that mean? It means you have to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, and then you're put into a position. You're in the family of God. You're put into a position whereby God is going to, not only does the Spirit of God indwell you at that point, and it's actively moving, the one that Jesus referred to as the Paracletos, the one that comes alongside that helps us to not only understand the word, but to grow in it. He's moving and helping us to make decisions in life, trying to lead out in our life. And so all this is happening is positional as a result of salvation. Through salvation, each one is in a position to worship and serve God. However, a believer's worship and service are made real or effective through day-to-day living for Christ. And so what that means is that not only is it positional, but it's made real or effective through day-to-day living, which means as we grow and as we learn and we begin to have the Word of God reveal itself, the truth unto us, and wash us essentially from that which we were as in practice to that which we are becoming in practice, then we put that into application each and every day. And that's when we really show how effective this process is, because we're living it day by day. Now, we don't always do that. I understand that, but we're striving to do that. And that's the goal. It is, and we're going to close with this. We only got a few minutes left. This is what Paul meant by his reference to the fact that the church, institutionally speaking, is sanctified and cleansed with the washing of water by the word. The word is the Bible. When a member of one of the Lord's churches studies the Bible, he or she learns what God wants them to do or not do. Such daily washing of the word keeps each one's life in harmony with the will of God and makes his or her testimony as a Christian more effective. And I want to close, because I think I found this late, kind of, and I was looking at it, and I thought, I'm going to add this because I want to read this to you in closing. But as I think it describes, the writer of this describes pretty well what is being talked about here. I'll go ahead and read, and I'll try to read it in a way where the brain can grab it. It says, how is the word of God like water? Ephesians 5:26. Well, it says, the Lord Jesus Christ purchased his church with his precious blood and also provided the means whereby it might be a distinctive body of saints who are truly sanctified and cleansed. Though sanctification does have a positional aspect to it, it also has a progressive experiential side to it as well. To be cleansed, a church must have the instruction of the inspired word of God to provide the counsel necessary for that cleansing. The practical application of the principles of the scriptures serve as a cleansing agent, much like water does a physical body. Paul probably had the Old Testament laver in mind as well. In the tabernacle, in the wilderness, and the temple in Jerusalem, the laver between the altar of sacrifice and the tent of meeting served as a basin for the preparation and cleansing of the Levitical priests for their service to the Lord. The washing of water by the word is the progressive means by which members of Christ's body can be properly cleansed and prepared to serve the Lord. So Christ died not only to establish and have the authority to empower the church to do the work that he wanted it to do, not only for it to yield to him service and honor and glory as a result, but that he could actually fulfill what he intended all along, and that was to provide the greatest things for them. Washing, regeneration by the word is a great blessing. When you face a situation in life, and sometimes you don't necessarily know how to do it, and you go to God's word and you can find the answers there and you can employ them, it's a huge benefit. I've handled the passing. I was at the last breath of my father, my mother, my grandmother, all believers. And I could handle those moments because I knew what the word told me about them, about that moment, about God's promises. So we weathered it differently. Do I miss them? Yeah, of course. I miss them. I love them. But in reality is they're in the presence of God. And I was thankful to be able to have them for the time that I did. But one day I'll have them eternally as I'll be there with them. And so I have peace in my spirit. And some people, they'll go through life without that because they don't understand or they don't know. And so I'm just saying God's word provides everything that we need. That's the thing. It validates itself. Everything it says, it does. And that's why we're here. That's why I'm here, because I know this. And I got to be better. I think we could all say that probably. We got to be better at allowing God's word to be that which directs our life. As an individual, as a spouse, as a church member, as an employee, as a friend, as a relative, as an in-law. Did I miss any? Because then we're going to experience the best and of our relationships, of our life. And there's going to be people that may not appreciate that viewpoint or that value. We'll weather that and we'll still be at peace because, like I said, it's better to do it God's way and to struggle than to do it the world's way and succeed. Because those things are temporary. God's is forever. All right. We'll close in a word of prayer. Gracious Holy Father, we come before you with thankful hearts for this day, for the blessings of it, Father, for giving us life and health. We repent of our sins, Lord, the things that we've done that's just fallen short, that just we look at each time we come to your word or to your house, we hear your word, it just reveals to us ourselves, Lord, the reflection of the mirror showing us who we are. It causes grief in the spirit, Lord. Just pray that we can do better, be better, and in Christ, according to your word, according to your will. Help your word to settle in our souls and just change us. Help us to yield to it, to overcome those things in life that we're tempted by. Help us to be a people that shine bright in humility and in spirit so that the world might see a people that's yielded to our great Savior and head. We ask, Father, that you'll move in us to be witnesses in the world. Help us to be good husbands and wives to our respective others. Father, let this be something that convicts us in every way. We pray, Father, now that you'll just go with us throughout the remainder of this. He brings a message now. And Father, we pray that you'll go with this service as it goes out into the world that might be beneficial to the hearer. And Father, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Silent flocks by night.